Okay, welcome, and I truly appreciate being here today. I enjoy talking, I enjoy being with people, and I asked Dr. Seip if I could introduce myself, because I think it's important for you to understand my background as we're getting into this topic. The topic talks about justice, which is the overarching topic for this entire STAR lecture series, Justice for All. And it talks about justice, technology, and homeland security. Very, very important in national security. Let me back up a little bit first. When I first went to college, I came from Bay City. Any of you from Bay City, Saginaw area? No one? Okay, well, it's a small community kind of up here. You know, in Michigan, we always point to ourselves. And up in that area, I loved playing the piano. I wanted to be a concert pianist. I went to Michigan State to be a concert pianist. And I soon realized that while I was good, I wasn't that good. Even though my parents and everybody said, wow, you're great. You're gonna be a great concert pianist, just like parents should be doing. So I went to Michigan State and decided, you know what? If I were gonna be a concert pianist, I'd be at Juilliard, not at Michigan State. And then went into something else interesting, archaeology. But I realized there aren't that many Indiana Jones out there. So I ended up in criminal justice. I wanted a degree, I wanted a job, I wanted something just like you that was challenging, innovative, someplace for me to go. I wanted to grow, I wanted to do things, I wanted to change. I was hungry, just like you. And so I went into criminal justice. At the time, people in the Michigan State Police, they hadn't hired any women, and they were just starting to, so that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to go in there and I wanted to grow, be a part of it. I spent 28 years in the state police, all over Michigan, a lot of it in the intelligence division. And then once I left, I said, I'm retiring, I'm gonna do nothing, I'm gonna sit, travel. And I decided I really couldn't do it because I enjoy being with people. I enjoy talking, interacting. Throughout my career, I had absolutely wonderful mentors, people who helped me, people who helped me grow, people who put me on the right track. At graduation in December, we had a Supreme Court Justice who was the keynote speaker. And she said, when you go out there and you graduate and you get jobs, are you gonna make mistakes? Yeah, all of us do. But we learn from them and we move on. And throughout my career I did, but I had wonderful mentors. And I said, you know what? I wanna come back, I wanna teach, I wanna share, I wanna mentor, whatever I can do to help. I got my PhD and came to Eastern Michigan University to teach here. So I'm really happy to be here and thank you for allowing me to speak here and to interact with some of you. I know some of you have already contacted me and I really appreciate that. So let's talk about a couple things first. This is not, even though it's a lecture series, I don't believe in standing here and lecturing to you. So I'm gonna ask for some feedback certain times too, because I think it's more important what you think of some of these ideas. So please, if I've asked, please, you know, speak out. One of the things I want to talk about first is justice. The overarching theme here was justice for all. So first of all, I want to ask from your perspective. You've had different speakers each one of the months, and they've talked about different areas of justice. So from your perspective, when you think justice, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? Just throw out a word. What?
Police.
Police? Judges? What else? What is it?
Fairness.
Mm-hmm. Fairness. What else? Corrections, jail.
Equality.
Excellent. Equality. Absolutely. Anything else?
Equality.
I'm sorry, what was that?
Equality.
Equal opportunity. And it's so important that you look at justice that way as I talk about justice and technology, justice and national security. Very, very important. Because justice is more than police, military, courts, corrections, jails. Justice talks about, as you have, some of you have said, equality, fairness. In fact, we talk a little bit about equality, dealing impartially, doing the right thing, righteousness. And even more importantly, that overarches the whole thing is balance. And when we start getting into some of this, that's the issue, is balance. Are we creating? If you look even on courts and some of the things that you talked about, what are they trying to do? They're trying to balance. They're trying to be equal, equality. And I'm not here to judge anybody or what, this is not a political discussion. Okay, but I think it's important that we look at justice from that perspective. One of the issues that I think is important when we talk about justice, though, is too many times even the favorite phrase is what? Justice for all, right? That's pretty much the phrase, justice for all. And there's nothing wrong with that, but when you say justice for all, what does that mean? What are you really saying? If you're talking about fairness, balance, equality, the problem if you say justice for all, there's almost a sense sometimes with people that there's an entitlement. I'm gonna stand here and it's up to everybody else to be fair. It's up to them to look at equality. Sometimes the better phrase is not justice for all, but what would be a different word instead of justice for all? What's another word? How about justice by all? Think about that for a minute. As I said, this is not going to be a lecture. I want you to think as we go through because I'm building on each one of these areas. If you start looking at justice and you say justice by all, that means that you have a part in that. You're not sitting back saying justice for all. Somebody else is going to do it. The courts, the judges, the politicians. You have a role in defining justice, balance, and equality. So it's justice by all. Yeah, it's for all too, but you have a role in it. One of the things I want to talk about in that is the issue, when we're still in the role of justice, the issue between leaders and all of you by being here are leaders. And I think it's important to talk about that real quick, and that's this. Every organization, every society, you have marchers and fighters, okay? So the marchers, right? Nothing wrong with that. Every organization, every job, culture, they have marchers. They're people who do things, they move along, but you also have leaders. The leaders are the people who are going to define where the justice is going to go. It's not defined for you. You don't sit back and let things happen to you. You become a part of what this is, justice by. So when we're going to get into technology, think about what role are you going to sit there and let things be defined for you, or are you going to be a part of it? Part of being at the university, part of being a part of the Honors College, or whether you're not, it doesn't matter. All of you are leaders by being here and by furthering education. That is so, so important. By being a leader, and let me stress, and you've had it, I'm sure, in classes, leader doesn't mean you have the highest title. Leader doesn't mean you make the most money, even though it'd be nice once you graduate, but no, leader doesn't mean you make the most money, okay? How many of you have sat in a group, even here at the university? And you can have a dean, you can have a professor, it doesn't matter. And as you're sitting in the group talking, there's somebody in that group who only speaks up once in a while. But what they say is very, very important. You listen to them because they don't say it much. But what they say is very thoughtful. And you say, you know what, that person makes a lot of sense. That person becomes the leader. So keep in mind, when you go out there and you think of yourself a leader, people think leaders have to be the one who stands up here. They have to be the one with the rank, the title, the money. No, that's not true. The leader has to be somebody that you listen to. And that's going to get back into the best. I'm kind of sad you didn't think it was funny. I kind of thought it was funny, but that's all right. We'll get to it at the end. The leader is people who listen to. Let me give you two examples here at the university. How many of you are from the History and Philosophy Department? Any of you there take classes from there? Do any of you know Dr. Schmitz, Phil Schmitz? Dr. Schmitz is just an outstanding person, and he doesn't say a lot. He's a quiet person, but when he speaks up, he is so insightful, so helpful, you listen to what he says, because he's given it a lot of thought. He doesn't give you tons of information, but what he gives you, you listen to because it's very important. Your job as leaders is to go out and find those other leaders and listen to them. Another one I want to tell you about is Dr. Al Bellamy, who's over in the College of Technology. He's another one. He's going to sit in a class as the instructor. He may sit in a meeting, and is he the one that's loudest, that talks all the time? Is he the one that's throwing ideas out the time, stamping his fists and everything? No, he's not. He's the one that sits back and listens, and every once in a while he throws an idea, or he throws a question. During a class, he throws a question out to get you thinking. Because it should never be, we're telling you what to do. It's, what can you offer? What can you offer? And it's important when you're looking at justice, equality, and everything, that you also don't look at everything you do is right, okay? The best leaders look for people who maybe challenge them and don't always agree with them. There's two leaders out there that I always use as great comparison. One, how many of you know Colin Powell, Secretary of State General? It's kind of a generational thing, I think. Colin Powell, if you ever get a chance, outstanding man. He was a general during the 1980s, during late 70s, 80s, early 90s, head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, went on to become Secretary of State under President Bush. Colin Powell, just an outstanding speaker. He didn't say much either. But when he spoke, people listened to him because he didn't speak that much. He thought about it, he listened to what everybody said, and then he spoke. On the opposite extreme, you had another general who was General Norman Schwarzkopf. And again, I'd ask, but probably most of you, if you haven't heard of General Colin Powell, then Norman Schwarzkopf was a general during that same time period. And what he did is, they called him Stormin' Norman. He was kind of like General MacArthur. He was loud, pounding his fist, but again, he was a great leader because he surrounded himself, even though he was loud, he surrounded himself with people who would challenge him and ask him questions. And they weren't afraid to say, I don't think that's the right way you're doing it. I think this may be a different way. That's what you want to surround yourself with if you're a great leader. And remember, leader isn't always the top person. You may just be working in a committee, okay? Leader, very important. But you bring other people who offer challenges to the way that you're thinking. That's what some of these lecture series and other things are about, is looking at different ways of looking at the same topic. We're going to get into technology and homeland security, and we're going to ask questions that are a little bit different, thinking differently. Okay? Colin Powell had a great quote, and he said, if the person next to you is a yes man, one of you is redundant. Get rid of them. Either get rid of yourself or get rid of the person. Because there's no need to surround yourself with people with yes men or yes people. Because all they're gonna do is say, great job, right? And you're gonna think everything you do is great because nobody's ever challenged you. Kind of like my family, when I was going to college, you're great, you're gonna be a great concert pianist, right? Until I get to college and I find out, okay, I'm not that great. But thanks, Mom and Dad, I appreciate the support, okay? So you need to be able to challenge yourself. Part of college is doing that. When you look at justice and we talk about balance, fairness, and everything, how do you know that you're being balanced, you're being fair? Some of it is challenge your own beliefs, challenging the way you look at things, very, very important. So you need to do that. So think about when you say justice for all, or is it justice by all? What role do you play in it? But let me get into technology. Let's roll into that and what role that plays. I'm out of the College of Technology. When I was in the state police, as I said, I was in intelligence division, but very much I got involved in technology because I realized you cannot keep doing things the same traditional way. You needed to become involved in technology. It's a way of life, it's a way of doing things, and you need to be innovative on how things are done. And I truly believed in it. The problem is that many times you have people on one side, one extreme, who say that technology, it's called technological determinism, which means technology defines the direction we're gonna go. It rules us. And there are people that believe that. Engineers, different people, my son's an engineer, loves technology. That's the way, that's the future, that's the way we're gonna go. It's gonna drive us. On the other side, you have people who say, no, we need to decide. Society will decide what technology and how it's gonna be used. The problem is, just like justice, there has to be a balance, somewhere in the middle. So let's look at an example of where technology may have taken over and may be driving us. We don't even notice that, okay? Can anybody think of something where technology is driving, where technology is steering the direction that we're going? Let me throw an idea out. How about online classes? And think about that. I teach online. I teach 100% online. All of our classes are online because of the fact is our program is designed for people who maybe went to college years ago and didn't finish. They were in the military, they had families. The average age of our student is 37 years old. They don't have time to come in. They have families, they're traveling, they're overseas, whatever it may be. So we need to do that. The problem is that when we started the online program, we offered online, a class that was hybrid, half and half, and a class that was 100% face-to-face. Because just like you, there are times you need a face-to-face class. You need somebody to talk to. You need to ask questions. Everybody learns differently. The problem was, we started this about 2007, 2008. And pretty soon what happened is, as we were offering the online classes, the hybrid and the face-to-face, we would only get two people on the face-to-face. Everybody wanted online because it was more convenient. So we got some in hybrid, some in online. We had to drop the face-to-face. Nobody would register for it. Even though some of them felt it was needed, they learned better, it was more convenient for them to do 100% online. Pretty soon, guess what happened? What's the next thing that happened? Yeah, they dropped the hybrid. Hybrid was like every other week or once a month you come to campus. It was very difficult for them. So pretty soon, because of technology, the only classes students are registering for many of the sections, not just in our program and others, are 100% online. That's it. Now, I'm not criticizing it. I teach it online. I understand the need. The problem is, where's the balance? Let's go back to the justice. Where's the balance on that? Because there still are people where they learn better elsewhere. They learn better face-to-face. They need that interaction. They need the questions. They need people to hear them. So in this case here, we have a situation where technology has begun to steer some of the education. How do we get that back? I'm not sure. That's one of the things we're talking about at the university. How do we offer a different learning environment to everybody when technology keeps steering the direction that we're going? So we have to be very careful that we, as we do this, we keep everything in balance. A couple other things they talk about, for example, anybody else think of another technology that's beginning to lose control? I'm not saying lose control, but beginning to be a little bit too much where they are leading. How about robotics? We love robotics, right? Great ideas, assembly line where it started, but look where robotics has taken us now. The problem is, can you stop that? Just like what we're doing here with online classes, how can we stop that anymore? Are we really servicing everyone? Even in the initial era of robotics, they're looking at robotics taking over jobs, taking over positions, taking over many things. Is that what we want? One of the issues that this comes into, and why I brought up the issue of leadership, is too many times we sit back and we say, that's the engineers, that's scientists, that's these people here, what can we do? There are things that you can do. You can be part of the solution. You don't sit back and allow others to decide the direction that you're going to go. Think of your own industry. Now, some of you, for example, may be going, let's say, for example, in banking industry. Do you think there is technology in banking industry? Yeah, of course there is. How about some of the other industries? We always think, for example, communications, telecommunications, manufacturing, aerospace. What about, let's say, a nonprofit? Because if we say technology, most people think phones, computers, telecommunication, right? Aerospace. But when you start thinking other areas, banking, how about nonprofit, a Boy Scout camp? Do you think there's technology there? Is there? Yeah. Just start thinking of some of the things that are going on. Absolutely, there's technology. Where the issue comes is when you sit back and you say, go talk to the IT people. Go talk to the technology people. They're the ones that will know. No, they're not the ones that will know necessarily. They know technology, but you need to work with them to help design something that's going to work for your company. I don't care if you're at McDonald's. I worked at McDonald's when I went to Michigan State. There's nothing wrong with that. I got a free meal every day. I was poor. Okay, 7-Eleven, doesn't matter. You look at every single one of these things you work in, there is technology. And you need to be a part of that, a voice of that. Do you go around demanding, oh my gosh, this is horrible, we need the status? No, you don't. But you can be part of the solution, part of the ideas of change that go on. Just because you're not IT, computer, an engineer or something, does not mean you should not be a part of that in your organization. And that's one of the things in technology management we do over there. We try to stress to everybody, you are a part of the solution. Remember justice, there have to be a balance. Let me give you a quick example. When I was in the state police, they were looking at laptop computers, and that's, you know, everywhere right now. But when it first started coming out as new technology, and they said, we need new laptop computers in the patrol cars. So what's the first thing they said? It's laptop computers, what do we do? Right? What do you do if somebody says, we need laptop computers for our patrol cars? Call the IT people. Okay, IT people said, okay. So they got a hold of purchasing and said, order 300 laptops. Okay, they order 300 laptops. 300 laptops come in. Picture the state police cars. Picture the UP when they're sitting outside in the cold. Picture them being in a hot car. You know yourselves, your laptops. I think I've fried about 3 Apple computers already. Just for water, jiggling them, dropping them, whatever it may be. Picture that. The problem was we shoved off the responsibility to technology. And I'm not in any way criticizing technology. I want you to understand that. Like I said, my son is in engineering, graduated in computer science. What I'm saying is that you don't shove that off. No matter what job you're going to graduate from, you become part of it. You become part of what it's going to do. We ended up with 300 laptops for 2 years sitting in the basement because there was nothing we could do. They were basic laptops. That's it. You start jiggling them, you bump them, it's in a hot car, a cold car, you go down, racing down the road, it goes over bumps, what's going to happen? Your laptop will last 1 day. That's it. It's moved in and out of the car. Okay. So obviously it didn't work. That's one of the reasons when I was in the department, they brought me in to head up a new division to say, we need to take the business of police work and marry it with technology. No longer can you sit back and say, call the IT people, they're gonna solve all your problems. That's not fair to them. You are part of it too. If you're in banking and you're a manager and you need something, don't you think you have an obligation to talk to somebody, to pull it together? Remember I said you have to have a balance between the two. So no matter what it is, you need to be a part of it. Let's move in from there into the technology where you need to be a part of it. So let's back up one more time because we're leading up to something here. We're going to kind of go full circle on this, but justice talks about balance, equality, leadership, being a part. Technology, talking about yes, technology is good. You need to also be a part. I don't care what your role is. I don't care what your title is, you need to be a part of it in some way. Now let's talk about national security. Okay. So we started off broad. Justice, went to technology. Let's talk about national security and what that has to do with justice and technology. Remember I said justice for all. And many times people in national security, when I'm talking about this to you, I want you to understand I'm doing this tonight not because I'm smart, not because I did my dissertation in it, not because I do research in it. Do you know why I do this? Because you are the leaders of the future. I'm not going to be the leader of the future. Dr. Sipes isn't going to be the leader of the future. You are the young people. You will be the leader of the future. You are the one that's going to help us move us forward, and you need to think about all of these issues as you move into whatever job. It doesn't matter what it is. You are the leader. When you start talking about national security, Justice is the balance. Technology, you need to be a part of that. Leader, it doesn't matter whether you are the head of the organization, whether you're on a committee, whether you're making recommendations. It doesn't matter. You be a part of it. But let's get to national security. National security, we hear that term all the time, and sadly what happens, I teach not only in technology management at the College of Technology, but I also teach for the Center of Regional and National Security. So I teach many of the executives in those areas throughout Michigan. And one of the things is that we talk about these areas, especially with national security. National security is not just a military. Okay? So if I say national security, what comes to mind? What are some things? Give me some words that come to mind for you.
Homeland security.
Homeland security. What else? If I say national security. One of the problems with national security is this. What's the one quote where they say, I don't know what it is, I can't define it, but if I saw it, I'd know what it is. I don't remember what that quote was. The problem with national security is, that's the issue. How do you define it? What is it? Can you put your finger on it? We all sit back and we say, it's the military, it's the police, it's the FBI, it's the CIA, it's everybody else that's going to make it secure. Okay? Because it's so big, it doesn't involve us. Let me give you a couple definitions, and I want you to understand how confusing this gets. Department of Defense, here is their definition of national security. Now let me tell you something. National security was not defined until 1947. We hear it all the time. We think it's been around forever. It hasn't. It's a new concept. So let's go back. It was created in 1947, the terminology. But the Department of Defense defines national security as this: a condition that provides military or defense advantage over foreign nations, and a defense posture successfully able to resist hostile action, right? So Department of Defense, military, we're talking about military defense advantage over foreign nations, or our posture successfully able to resist hostile action. Homeland Security talks about concerted national effort to prevent terrorist attacks, reduce a nation's vulnerability, terrorism, okay? They also have, they oversee many of the things that FEMA, Federal Emergency Management. But let's then look at President Obama, okay? So let's look at one extreme and let's look. Now this is his definition based on a national security strategy. Security of a nation, this is how he defines national security. Security of a nation, a strong, innovative, and growing economy, respect for values, and an international order advanced by U.S. leadership. Okay, let's go back to these again. They're all definitions of national security. We all sit back, right? You sit back, your family sits back, everybody sits back. National security, they're gonna take care of us. Money, technology that is being designed and innovated for these. Let's go back to Department of Defense. Military defense advantage over foreign nations, defensive posture, resist hostile action. What kind of technology are we talking about for that? For that definition, what kind of technology would we be talking about? What ideas? What technology? Would we be talking about weapons? Would we be talking about military type weapons? If you're talking about hostile nations, absolutely. Let's go to the other extreme, President Obama. Security of a nation, strong innovation, growing economy, respect for values, and an international order advanced by U.S. leadership. What kind of technology would be used for that, that we're going to spend money on? Do you think what he's talking about is necessarily military, guns, tanks? I'm not saying there's anything wrong with any one of those. I want you to understand that it is not a good, solid definition of what is we're talking about. Money is being spent on technology. Money is being moved forward on different issues having to do with these. We need to understand all of these are part of making us secure. But what role do you play when you get involved in this? Um, So when you're looking at a balance, there's a paper that was done. If you ever get a chance, actually an excellent paper. It was done by Major Benjamin Taylor. He did a master's thesis, and it had to do with the innovation in the rise and fall of great powers, lessons for America. It had to do with technology. What he said, he went back to early nations and looked at all the great powers from all over the world and why they died out. He looked at it actually from a technology standpoint and said, what was it about these nations that they died out? And that we have now reached the area where we are a more strong nation. And what he said and what he found, the trend he looked at, was that at the point we no longer had a balance, that we ended up putting too much money in one way or another, too much emphasis. There wasn't a balance that the nations folded. So what your role then becomes here, and you as our future, your role is to help create that balance, to understand that justice with technology. Many people don't realize that technology is a justice. Absolutely. You need to have a balance on what's designed. There are people out there designing things, scientists, engineers, because they can. In our classes, we talk about ethics. And we talk about, are you building it because you can or because you should? Who's the people who are going to oversee those things? You know what? Many of you down the road, managers, heads of organizations, you are going to make the decision. Is this something just because we can? It's a technology. It's a great idea. We can. Let's do it. Is that the right idea? Is that something we even should be doing? There are technologies that are outlawed by our country, but they are being invented or innovated in other countries. Okay. So far we have a balance, we're able to do it. In the area of national security, I want you to think about a couple things that are going on with technology and give thought to, are these things we should, shouldn't do? For example, how about cameras on street corners? Okay, right now many cities are implementing more cameras on street corners. And they're used very effectively. On the freeways, they're used for accidents, people injured. Instead of trying to send a car, especially if it's a long distance, they're able to look and they're able to identify these people and send an ambulance, whatever it may be. They're able to identify plates. What about GPS on your cars? Good idea. Let's go a little further, though. What about chips, ID chips, that can be injected in your body to ID who you are? Okay, is that a good technology? Yeah, in some cases it is. How about RFID on your tags, on your clothing? Because they have those now. So sometimes you buy clothes, it has an RFID tag. They use it supposedly for marketing, and they can then see what clothes are being purchased, what stores, that type of thing, even what areas of the country it's going. So you have RFID tags on your clothing. Those are all technologies, but can they also be used for national security? Do you think those can also be used for national security? Yeah. Okay. Those are all things that can be used, but can it also be used for unintended consequences for another area? We also have classes that we talk about, not just about ethics, about the issues that you have to look at and say, should we even be inventing these things? But we also look at some of these technologies then and we say, what's the unintended consequence? Are there positive and negative unintended consequences? For example, dynamite, we'll say. Okay, dynamite was invented, was used for mining operations, but look where it's taken us. Wilbur and Orville Wright, the airplane, they made it. They wanted it for pleasure, for people to fly. Eventually, it began used for other things too. So there's two sides to everything. The role of the future leaders, the role of the people, which is you, is to help create that balance, that justice for everything that's going on. Technology is going to continue to grow, and it's going to grow in the area of homeland security because much of the technology that we have today is going to be used for homeland security. We want a safe nation. We want a secure nation. It's extremely important. But we also have to balance that with our privacy. And that's not what this is about tonight. That's time for another one. But the balance with national security becomes privacy. And I think you see that in the news today. Okay? What is right? What is not? Where do you draw the line for our security? I don't know. That's up for a discussion in the future. Dr. Seip talked about the STAR lecture series for next year. One of the things that I hope you do at the end of this semester is when they talk about the STAR lecture series next year, I hope rather than just putting a card and suggesting an instructor or a topic or something like that, many times, remember I said part of the idea isn't just listening to one person, it's getting different viewpoints, people who don't agree. So while I may say something, you may would be better off maybe, what about four or five people talking about it and coming at it from a different perspective? As you're coming up with ideas for next year, please give thought to what are some of the different things where you can bring diverse people to challenge each other on the stage. We're used to that, that's not an issue. We'd like people who disagree with us. There's nothing wrong with it, and that's important for you to see. It's important for you to hear that there's nothing wrong with it. It's also important for you to see how do you disagree on these issues? How do you challenge each other? Because when you go out there and you get your jobs, remember, you're here because you're leaders. And when you get those jobs, part of it is going to be to question, challenge, whatever it may be that you're involved in. But you have to do it the right way. Unfortunately, when I first went out from college, you know, nobody talked to me about that. And I went out and I was a little bit rabble-rouser and until somebody took me aside and said, you know, there's a right and a wrong way to challenge people. Very, very important. When you get out there and you challenge having to do with technology, even when you're looking at issues of national security, and I hope you're reading things that are going on all the time right now, look at all the sides, look at all the viewpoints, decide for yourself. And next year when you bring these people up here to talk, look at maybe instead of one, why don't you bring three or four with different viewpoints, challenging viewpoints, and let them argue, let them talk, ask questions of them, come up with different ideas that will help them. And that's going to make it even richer for you. Because as I said, you're the leader, you're going to be going out, learn from this, take it back, whether it's to school, whether your job, whatever it is, that's what's important. Now let me talk about. Back when I was first in the state police, myself and another woman were the first two women to ever, we were going to work the road. In the past, they had women, they worked juvenile, sometimes they worked the desk, sometimes they worked intelligence, something like that. But we're the first ones that were actually going to go out on patrol. We went through the academy with everybody else. One of the things that all police officers wear are bulletproof vests. Well, being a woman, the way that we're shaped, we couldn't wear the traditional vest. It was kind of flat in the front, flat in the back, and it just didn't work. So they went back to the companies that were designing these, the engineers, the technologists, and said, we have women with breasts, and you need to come up with some type of bulletproof vest that they can wear out on patrol. So the other female and I were the first two women, so they brought prototypes out for us to wear. One of the prototypes looked almost exactly like this, and that's exactly what they brought out to us. And they expected us to wear this under a shirt. Of course, we would have had to get a bigger shirt. But you kind of felt like a Viking, a Valkyrie or something, you know, wearing these things. It was the funniest thing you've ever seen. Now, what we could have done was this technology, was the bulletproof vest technology? Yes. Think about the material, not necessarily the design, but think about the material. Was it technology? Absolutely. Was it innovative? Absolutely. But they designed it, the engineers, the people, the textile, they designed it by themselves. They brought it out and thought, this is what we are going to wear. This is what we're going to do. Because they said, make a bulletproof vest for the women. This is what they came up with. So they brought it out. Obviously, they gave us a bigger shirt. We put over it. It was the silliest thing I've ever worn. And I could easily have said, oh my God, I could have, you know, stomped my feet. I could have told them they were foolish, whatever it may be. But instead, at least I was smart enough to say, this isn't going to work. We need to come up with something better. something that we can wear, other women, military, something where there's a balance. Because the whole thing of wearing this is for our protection. It's not to make us look silly. Okay? And they didn't do this to make us look silly. Keep in mind, some of the technology that you look at out there and you go, where were their heads? They didn't do it because of that. They thought they were doing the right thing. But they needed somebody else to come in and offer them a challenge and offer them a different way of looking at it and say, this isn't going to work. You need to look at it differently. And that's what I did with this. Myself, we sat down, we came up with one, we tried several prototypes, and to this day, that basic prototype is what's worn by women in law enforcement and in the military. So when you go out there, if there's anything I can tell you, you are the leaders. I really wish all of you the best. How exciting, what an exciting time for each and every one of you. Remember that justice isn't to you. You have a role. You have a role of being a part of it, part of the change. The technology, don't be shoving people and saying, go talk to the technology, go talk to the engineers, they'll take care of it. You have to be a part of whatever comes up. I don't care what your position is or what field you're going to go in. And even with national security, that is so important right now. And it's an excellent thing to look at as an example, to say, are these things making us secure? Is this something we should be doing? Is there something I can be a part of that? Okay. So the next time you start, you have a job and somebody comes in and asks for some help and you say, go see the IT people, think of something like that and maybe be a part of the solution for them, okay? So I would like to thank all of you for having me here tonight. I appreciate this. I wish you all the best because, as I said, you are the future. You are the leaders. I envy each and every one of you. I respect each and every one of you for being here and for getting your degrees and for going to school. I wish I was quite a few years younger, but I'm not. So I wish each of you the best. Godspeed and congratulations. Take care. Thank you.